Hi, I'm Jazzy from Maya Sewing. Today we're going to talk about two different machines, but very similar. Here is the Ballad, the Baby Lock Ballad, and here is the Chorus. I don't have the top on it because we already have this set up with some of the accessories that it includes. So what we're going to do today is I'm going to demonstrate everything on the Chorus, and I will tell you the differences between the Chorus and the Ballad when I get to them in the future, okay? Terrific. Well, let's get started. Hi. So here we are. We've got the Chorus all set up and we will get just going. So your cord is on the right hand side of your machine, and then it comes with this dual foot, and we will show you how, I'll show you how to set that up. We're just gonna plug it in and then I'll turn it on. When it turns up, it doesn't start up like a regular machine. It sings. We like singing. All right. Now you get this screen when you first come up. You won't see anything until you tap it. This particular machine and the Ballad come with a stylus, and this machine, the Chorus only, comes with a pen. We're not going to use that one right now. So you can tap. All right. And then you see on your LCD screen, you get all these stitches. They show you 16, but if you move them down, you can see how more stitches you have. This tells you how many pages it has, 3 of 3 pages that you're on, 2 of 3 pages. And right now these are all utilities. Whoops, these are all utility stitches. It also gives you a huge variety of stitches. You have over 700 stitches. Both the Chorus and the Ballad have over 700 stitches, and that includes character decorative stitches along with your utility stitches. Some of them are very unique. You have a section just for quilting, and which is on the bottom section, and it's called, it has a little Q next to it. Right above that one, you can sew very strangely. Instead of just going back and forth, it can actually go at an angle or left and right, and we'll go over that. You have a section of just buttonholes and darning, and you have a section of some of these are heirloom stitches and some of these are knit stitches. So you have a huge variety of choices. You go into your character decorative stitches. Now it's asking me, is it okay to delete the selected pattern? What I did was I accidentally touched the screen on a pattern and it just brought it up right away. It was just an accident. I don't want to save it. I don't want to stay here. So I'm going to delete it. I don't permanently delete it. It's just deleted off of what I was doing. When I go into the character decorative stitches, there's a whole bunch of different screens. Your screen changes slightly. Everything is like a peach color now. It has 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and then you have all your lettering. We'll go into 6 just to show you what it looks like. It looks set up just the same way as your utility stitches are. These are a little longer, a little wider. Instead of having 16, there's only 10 on this one. This one is page 1 of 36. So then you would go on, and you can go either way. So from 36 to 36. So these are pretty large, you'll see them. And we are not going through all 700 and plus stitches, but you have a whole bunch of different styles of stitches. Your book will give you more details about exactly which one they are. We'll do a few here and there, but we're not doing every stitch. So I'm going to close this where it says close. And all it did was bring me right back to still I'm in the character decorative stitches. Go into 7. Again, this is 1 of 14 pages. Gives you a variety of stitches. If I don't want any of those, I close that again. This is 8, screen 8. This is 1 of 9 pages. These are your satin stitches here in number 9. So you have 20 different stitches here. This here, you can use for, that's called faggoting. It's the old-fashioned gathering and stitching different things together. You used to be able to put elastic in them. Old-fashioned dresses were done that. You can do that, and it's also, I believe they call it cross stitch too. All right, over to number 11. These in here, looking at them, These look exactly like the decorative, the utility stitches, but they're considered the decorative stitches also. And then your final one is your lettering, so you can monogram and write words out. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different fonts. And each font you have capital, lowercase, your numbers with some math symbols, and you have your regular plus minus, that kind of thing, with exclamation points, and then you have letters with accents over them in two different styles. All right, I'm gonna close that. I'm gonna go back to utility stitches. Gee, we haven't even made a bobbin yet. All right, there's a whole lot going on here. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take this step by step. Let's start with just setting up the machine, okay? So you can just start sewing. Let's keep it simple. Do you have to attach your sensor pen to start sewing? No, you do not. Okay, so that's kind of a good thing if you just wanna start slow and then work your way up. The dual foot is a great foot pedal because you can do multiple things with it. So in order to get there, so I can figure out what I want in the small pedal and the large pedal, down at the very bottom looks like a little piece of paper with lines on it, and that's your settings. Okay, we're on page 1 of 7 pages. In here, all your settings. So we have at the top, we can change this button here, which is your speed control. We can change it to width control for any pattern that has a width, like a zigzag. All right, in here you have fine adjustment vertical. Is all, you have more stuff than you can possibly imagine, but I wanna go through a few of them for you. So we have a dual feed adjustment. So your dual feed is this, and it plugs in, and I'll show you how it plugs in. It actually has an adjustment, how high it goes. It's kind of neat how you can do that also. So if you're doing extra thick fabrics, you can actually raise that foot up. To arrow key over, you just hit the right arrow. All right, so here we are. So this is telling me the very top one, the initial position of when I first turn the machine on. Do I want the needle to be on the far left, or do I want it to be on the center? I have it set for the center. That's usually what most people like. If you don't like it, you can change it to the left. The initial stitch page tells you, all right, so what am I gonna look at the moment I turn it on? Which page do I want? Do I want the standard utility stitches, which is currently highlighted in blue, or do I want the one next to it, which is the quilting stitches? So if you're mostly a quilter and that's what you're gonna be doing on this machine, mostly, then you could change it and you could do the initial page would be your quilting page of their stitches. All right, below that is your multifunction foot controller. This will not work and it won't show anything up unless the foot controller is plugged in prior to turning the machine on. When you get your machine, this will come in 3 pieces. It'll come with this pedal, this bar, and then this pedal. You'll see that there's a wire coming from the small, you put it into the large pedal, and then there are 2 simple screws that you can hand tighten, nothing fancy. You can choose where you want your pedal. There's 2 holes here, and there's 2 holes here. So you can have them farther apart or equal or however you want them, okay? So we just have it set up. All right. The picture that it shows that, let's see, this is your main pedal here. Okay, so if we're pressing down on it just to sew, we're gonna press down like this way. And I don't have any thread in it, so I can do this. Ah, I forgot to put the presser foot down. All right, which is kind of a nice benefit. All right, so then we can just press and it'll sew. Ah, it says the bobbin is almost empty. I don't have a bobbin in it. So we have just learned something new on that also. I'm gonna say close on that, but that is for when you sew. You saw the little needle going up and down. We're good to go with that. All right, there's little arrows. I'm gonna choose the right one, and it says no settings. So if I just wanna use this as my foot controller for sewing, then I'm gonna put no settings, and that's all it's gonna be. Now, if I wanna add something by pushing the bottom of the petal, not the top, the bottom. Think of it as a gas pedal. If you're driving, you're going to push down at the top, okay? With this, you push down at the top, it'll make the machine go. Push down at the bottom, it can do a couple of things. One, nothing, or we can choose. We can tell it that's where I want to cut my thread. So if I push this down on this end, it'll cut the thread. Or I can do needle position. So if right currently now, it's in the up position. If I choose this and push down, the needle goes down, okay? I'm gonna put it back up by pressing it again, and that's what that does. And the reason why I can do that while we're doing it, one, it has no thread, and two, I'm changing it as we go. We can do a single stitch, literally one stitch. So for whatever reason, if you do something that requires one stitch and you do a lot of it, you can program the foot to just push down on the front and it will stitch one stitch. You can also do the reverse stitch at this point too, putting it on the front of the pedal. And let's see, and press a foot up and down. So if I do a lot of up and down, up and down, up and down, and I don't want to use one of my buttons on the screen or on the front of the machine, I can do it on my pedal. I can lift the foot up and then put the foot back down. And then go back to no settings, okay? I'll be honest, we would not do the thread cutting, only because if you get in the habit of obviously powering your machine with your right foot and you push forward with that part, if you accidentally push incorrectly and do that, you're going to cut your thread in the middle of a stitch. So I don't advise thread cutting on your right-sided pedal. Needle position up and down can also be very good. You can do that. A single stitch, I don't know if I do a lot of single stitch stitching. I'll be honest, I'm not sure if that's just to add an extra stitch at the end of something. Reverse stitch would be very good, but this machine comes with something that's automatic backstitch, where you can program it to, you can push a button and it'll automatically backstitch and cut your fabric. I'm sorry, your thread. All right. Press your foot up and down, that's a real good one, just because it's a little easy. All right, we've gone through all of them. Now, let's go over to the left pedal. The left pedal has a lot of similarities to the first pedal, except it doesn't go for speed and doesn't make your machine go. We have a choice. We can do reverse stitch, which we just talked about on the first one. I doubt if you're gonna have both pedals do the same exact thing, it would be a little confusing. The left pedal can also do presser foot up and down. You can do no settings at all. You can do thread cutting, which I like, especially if you just want to set the machine to backstitch, but you want to cut it. So say if you're chain stitching, you don't want to cut every time you go to the next chain piece if you're chaining a quilt pattern. That kind of thread cutter is nice, so you can do it at the very end. Needle position up and down. With the left pedal, a single stitch also on the left pedal. So actually it does almost the exact same thing as the right pedal. So you kind of have to choose which one you like and which one goes on what foot. So obviously the right one will go for making the machine go. I don't know if I would do the reverse stitch. Let's do, where is it? Presser foot up and down. I like that one. And on the left pedal, let's do, where is the thread cutting? I will do the thread cutting on that one, okay? So we're gonna keep that the way it is, and let's try it out. So if I push down on the front, it lifts the presser foot up. If I push it back down on the right side, the presser foot comes back down. If I hit the left pedal, it's gonna cut the thread. Granted, I don't have any thread in there, but if it was there, I would cut it. So we're gonna leave that just the way it is. All right, and now that was page 2. Let's go over to page 3. We have a variety of settings in here. Automatic fabric sensor system, I usually keep that on. Reinforcement priority, It's up to you. You can keep it on and off. We'll leave it off for now. We have the guideline marker adjustment, which is your laser, which the Chorus has exclusively for a regular standard sewing machine only. We have an automatic presser foot lift. We have needle positions. We have the mouse pointer. So if you wanted to connect a mouse instead of using your stylus or your finger or the sensor pen, then you can actually just use a mouse, like a computer mouse. Has to be one that can attach. You cannot do a wireless. We want the upper and bobbin thread sensor. What that means is if I break a thread up here while I'm stitching and I'm not paying attention, or my bobbin is running out, the machine will tell me. And that's a nice sensor to have on. We have volume on the machine, so we can make it loud. So that's kind of loud. And then we can shut it off completely. We'll keep it at 3 for now. All right. We can have an automatic shut-off mode on this machine. You can change your opening screen, and you can change the language in the machine also. Right now, we currently have the light on high, and we can dim it to go completely off, okay? We normally, when we're sewing, at least when we're demonstrating, we like to have it bright. Screen brightness, that's this screen. So right now it's on a 4. Let's put it up to 5 so you can see how bright it gets. And then it goes to 1, which is very dim. So I suppose if you're sewing at night and you don't want to wake somebody up, it's okay to have. But I'm going to put it back up. All right. And then the sensor function calibration, which is for your sensor pen here, which we'll take care of later. And the last screen, it will give you the amount of stitches that this has stitched. So since we've had put this one on the floor, it has only had 1,728 stitches. There's been 2 different versions of upgrades, and we've put them up. So that's there also. So if you have any other issues, you have your close button to close this screen completely. And then on the right, it says USB media is not loaded. So if I have a possibly some stitches that I've done and I save them and I put them on a jump drive, you can actually put it in and take that. But we don't need that, which is kind of cool. Down below, we've talked about the setting, is a question mark. So this is your operation guide. And you can literally go through this on your screen. Talks about all your buttons. So if you're not sure what it is, you can press it and it will tell you, show you where it is on your machine. And then it will tell what it's for. All right. Close that. Go back again. Here is sewing guide. Can give you an idea of this particular, shows you something. This is a shirt with ruffles and scallop edge. This is a top stitch, blind hem, zippers. And in here we've got piecing, free motion quilting, and quilting. So if we choose piecing, it can tell you what stitches to use, which ones in your machine. It even gives you the number and the letters of where it would be. Okay. If you're not sure what it is, come on. It's not letting me do it. Well, it tells you what it is. Anyhow, I thought it would show me something more, but it's not. So the Q-01 is a piecing stitch where the needle is in the middle. So that would be used when you have your quarter inch foot. Let's go back. This talks about echo quilting, and you notice that the needle moved right away. And so that shows you what foot you would use, which is kind of nice. It gives you an idea. It teaches you, it shows you how you can echo and how far you would go from each one. Let's go close that. This is a variety. This has 7 different screens. It gives you all different ideas. It shows you how to take your foot off, how to put your glide foot on. It gives you an idea of exactly what to do to teach you. So your machine can teach a lot. You just need to take the time to read it. All right, we're gonna close that. Let's close that again. And then we have pattern explanations. So those who are a little confused with certain things, we can do tells you straight stitch, your general sewing, goes to foot width. It goes to a lot of different things you can talk about if you're not sure of what you're doing. So this is a great help aid. I'm going to close that screen. Okay, we went back to the screen itself. This here, it looks like it shows a picture of the ankle, the foot, and the needle, and then arrows. Let's do this. I'm going to push it, and it says okay to automatically lower the presser foot. I'm going to say yes. Okay, notice that the screen completely changes. It just goes fuzzy almost where you can't do it. This is one way to lock your machine. This also is good for when you're threading. If you're threading manually, if you've got grandkids, this is one way to lock them out. As long as they don't see the button on the bottom, you're pretty safe. We're gonna unlock it. Here, right on the right, is your clock. So today, is it today the 9th? It is. So we can put the time that it's on. You can do a 24-hour clock and set it on your own. Display on or off. Okay, and I left it. It says off. Let's put it back on. And then you can see the actual numbers displayed. Okay. All right. So we've talked about utility stitches. We've talked about character stitches. All right, right here is a little pocket. That is your memory. So when you push that button, it says I can retrieve something that I've already saved in the machine. I can put it in memory, or I can reset the whole machine. Okay, so that's an option for when you're working with maybe creating a pattern with different decorative patterns to do a decorative stitch. All right. So far, everything we've talked about, minus this pen, which we've not talked too much about, is everything the Ballad can do also. So the Ballad and the Chorus at this point are still the same. Looking at the machine, you can see it. This comes with the Ballad also. It's telescopic thread, and you can put taller spools on. Say if you bought a king size spool of Robeson Anton, it wouldn't fit on a standard one like this. Only the mini kings do. The big ones are much larger, so you could put them here. And then you'd follow the telescopic. This would go all the way up so it doesn't tangle. All right, here is where you would fill a bobbin. You can fill a bobbin off of your regular spool. You could also fill it here if you're using the king size, or you can do it here. And we'll fill a bobbin also. I don't have the cover on here. It's completely off because we put your piece here for your cones. Your machine in the front will look the same as the Ballad if you have the Ballad instead of the Chorus. You have your start and stop button. So if you were choosing to not use your foot pedal and you wanted to sew with speed, you can do that. As soon as I drop the foot, you can see that the start and stop button turns green for go. This one above it is upside down U with an arrow. That is your back stitch. It goes back three. When you program it in here on your screen, it'll go back three stitches. Otherwise, it'll go one at a time. Above it, I call it the donut. It's also the reinforcement stitch. To the right of that, just drop the needle once because I don't have it programmed to do anything. So I can go right next door to it and tell it to lift the needle. Next to that is your manual cut stitch. It just goes down and cuts. This is your presser foot up and down. So notice when it's up and I have the pedal unplugged, it will not let me sew. It'll tell me use the presser foot lifter button to lower the presser foot before I can stitch. Here is your speed control, the slowest to the widest, to the fastest, sorry. And it can also, you can program it to do the width of stitches. And here is your automatic threader. All right, so let's slow it down. All right, so how about let's go on to making a bobbin. So now we're going to make a bobbin. Before we do that, because we'll have to put the spool of thread on the spool pin, we're going to talk about a little bit about the accessories that you will receive with your machine. You have a variety of feet. There are 13 different feet. You have your standard feet here, your buttonholer, your sewing foot, zipper foot. I'm not going to go through every one. We'll be here too long. You get a buttonhole maker, button stitcher, excuse me. You have extra...
I can't see those.
You can't see those. All right, you get your digital dual feet. You'll get a couple of different plates for cover plates for your bobbin case. They're for different reasons. This one has the quarter inch on it, and these don't have any markings at all on them. You'll receive a twin needle and a pack of mixed needles. You have an eyelet punch, your nets. These are nets for thread that comes off the spool too quickly. An extension, you've got a bunch of screwdrivers, cleaning tool, another little screwdriver. But the reason why I took all this out was because with the machine, you get a variety of thread stoppers. You get a large, a medium, small, and then you get a mini, which is right there. And that's the one we're using today. That's how you keep your thread on. Comes with a little pouch to put all these things in. And we'll put them all away. You'll also get a glide foot for quilting. You'll get a free motion foot for quilting. And this is another one that you can quilt with, another foot. And that's a closed circle. You get a straight plate with the straight foot. This only has a hole in it where the foot that's in there now has more of a cut in it so the needle can move left and right. All right, bobbins and a bobbin case. So you get plenty of little doodads. The Ballad and the Chorus come with the same accessories. Your digital dual foot is basically your walking foot. All right. So we're going to do our bobbin in red. And put the spool on. And this spool cap is to match the size of the spool ending. So this one fits perfectly in the Robeson Anton and in the Glide. On your machine, on the top, which you can't see from the camera angle, but trust me, it tells you exactly how to thread your machine according to make a bobbin. You can use this spool pin or this one, either way. The reason we have two is because you could be stitching and you can make a bobbin at the same time. So we're gonna go this way. We're gonna come up and under the number one. And then we're going to come over. Actually, we don't have to do that. Well, yeah, I suppose we can. We'll go this way. So I don't know if you can see it because it's red thread. It's kind of thin. Go under the middle piece here. I'm going to go all the way over to the little hook in the back. I'm going to hold it down so it doesn't go anywhere. I'm going to wrap around the tension screw so I can make my bobbin. I'm going to wrap it around from the back to the front. On here, you have little openings here and on the exact opposite side. That is a little tiny cutter inside, so you can literally tuck the thread and pull it, and it's not going to go anywhere. To make a bobbin on this one, we're going to move this piece here over to the bobbin. We don't move the bobbin to the piece. And then here, it shows you your bobbin winder. Close, start, and you have a minus and a plus sign. We're gonna go down here. We don't need a ton of bobbin, and we don't wanna spend all our time making a bobbin. But this will fill it, and it'll tell you, I'm telling it how much I wanna put on it. I'll hit start. I don't have to step on my foot pedal. Okay, it didn't stop, so I stopped it. When you're done with it, you push the stop button, unclick it. If you don't have a pair of scissors with you, you can actually take the thread, slide it into that cut. And that works too. All right, I'm going to take this piece off. has a cap on there too. All right, I'm going to put black thread in it when we thread the machine. All right, so I'm going to put the glide on and put my mini spool pin in there. And this is going to show me how to thread it. I'm going to follow the numbers and the solid line. So I'm going to come up under one, go into the back, over to number two, and then I'm going to come down. Go all the way down. Hang on a second. My foot was down. You should always thread your foot, thread your machine with the foot up. And that's so we can get into the tension discs that are behind here, okay? I usually hold my thread a little bit. I go down to number three. I'm going to come up to the left and come back up. Number four is back all the way over to the left, and then I'm going to pull down. And I missed it because I can't see what I'm doing. There we go. Sorry, I couldn't see. Once you get past number four, you can actually put your foot down. When you tug on the thread, you'll feel the tension. If you can't feel any tension at all, it's just loose, then you might have missed the tension disc, so I would lift the foot and re-thread it. Come down to number five. You have a number six, which is right above the needle here. Now I'm gonna take the thread, I'm gonna put it here in this little opening, catch number seven, come to the side, and I'm gonna cut the thread. All right, so that over seven, cut the thread. Now all I have to do is push the thread button. And there we go. Pull it out, perfect. All right, so I'm gonna lift the foot back up. Take my bobbin cover off. When you put your bobbin in, it's gonna be P for perfect, so it comes off the left side. Drop it down. I usually hold my bobbin, catch that little front piece, like around the 6 o'clock, and bring it over and cut the thread off. Put the tooth in first on your cover and lock it in place. All right, so we've made a bobbin, and we just put the bobbin in our machine and threaded it. This particular table, and I didn't mention it prior, this only comes with the chorus. If you'd like one for your ballad, just give us a call and we can order one for you. They're not too expensive and they're a great help when you're quilting or even sewing something large. All right, so talked about the table. So now the next thing we're gonna do is, remember when we talked about the foot pedal and I showed you what we did and we kind of programmed it? All right, if you remember, right pedal, if you push it forward, it makes it go. Pushing it back makes the needle go up and down, and then the left pedal, I believe we set it for cut. So I don't have anything, I didn't program anything. We're in a straight stitch. So here's my fabric. I'm going to step at the front of the right pedal, and it drops my pedal. So now I'm going to stitch. That's nice and smooth. All right, we get almost to the end. And now it's all I want to do, and I want to cut the thread. I want to lift my pedal. I'm still no hands. All right, look at that. And I cut it. So that's pretty cool. I think that's pretty neat. I like the dual foot pedals because you can do a lot. Our stitching is really nice. You can't even see anything. It's a nice even stitch. There's red on my bobbin and black on the top, and you can't see either color coming through the other side. I like that. All right, so now we're going to try to use our foot pedal. But if we didn't want to use our foot pedal and we still wanted to sew, well, we can still use the foot pedal and all our control buttons. So let's do them up here. So here, this little foot, this drops my foot. So I can still sew and stitch. And I can stop. And then if I use my cut, I can cut it. And then I can lift my foot. So I have a variety of ways I can stitch. So another thing we can do, let's look over to the screen. I have a couple of almost gold-like icons. There's four of them. Okay, the top one here, I'm gonna push it and it turns kind of like a darker orange. That is for a pivot. So that means when I'm stitching, and I start going, when I lift my foot off the pedal, my foot comes up, see? Light is still green because I can still sew, but my foot is up, my needle is down. So if I needed to pivot, I could pivot here. Or if I was just doing chain stitching and I didn't want to have to keep lifting the pedal up and down and I didn't want to use my foot when I programmed my foot pedal. So then if I wanted to continue to sew, I'm still just going to continue to stitch. And I stop and it lifts. Okay, a lot of quilters love this feature because it stops us from having to lift the foot up and down, up and down. All right, so we're going to cut the thread. All right, and it automatically goes to the upright position because we've told it we want it to pivot. So when it's done stitching and you either backstitched and or cut, the foot will go in the upright position. All right, next one. The next button here, it looks like an upside down U with an arrow and then a dot, and that is your backstitch and reinforcement stitch. I'm going to choose that. So then with this particular stitch that I've chosen, the very first stitch, it says that it is going to do a backstitch first. And so let's see what it does. I'm going to drop my foot and then we'll see. One, it's going forward three. Now it's going to go backwards three. And then it will continue. Now, because I've programmed it in here, if I push my backstitch, whether I use my foot or not, if I don't use my foot, it's going to go backwards on its own three, go forward three, and then stop. I didn't tell it to cut it. I can do that manually if I'd like. All right, again, because the pivot is on, it lifts the foot. I don't want to push the cut button all the time. So I'm going to tell it and I'm going to program it. Okay, so let's try it again. Now, we can drop our foot with the button or I can drop it with the foot pedal. Okay, and let's see what it does. One, two, three, forward, and now it's going to go backwards because we told it we wanted to reinforce by itself or backstitch by itself. We're going to stitch. I'm going to hit the backstitch button, take my foot off the pedal. And that noise that you heard was it cutting. So I don't do much. It's pretty cool. All right. If we want to do that again, we want to use the reinforcement stitch. Let's chain stitches. I'm going to go to the second stitch, which has the dot right above the stitch. Now I've already dropped the foot with my foot pedal because I've programmed it. And now I'm going to stitch forward. Now you'll watch the needle and it's going to go three stitches in the same exact spot. That is a reinforcement stitch. One, two, and three, and now it'll go forward. And then I'll stop it by, I can end it with using a reinforcement or a backstitch, either one. If I use the reinforcement stitch, it'll go three in the same spot, and then it cuts because I told it to cut. Okay? The machine will not program. You cannot program the machine to cut without backstitching. If I try to shut the backstitch off, the cut goes off also. If I don't want to backstitch, I can leave them off and then just cut with my cut button here on the front of your machine. Okay? All right, let's go back here. It's kind of fun to be able to just step it on your foot. All right, let's go to we're in our utility stitches, and I've got three pages. So this is a lot of stitches. There's knit stitches, and there's all kinds of different stitches you can use. Let's go down. Oh, how about if we do some crazy stuff? I am in section 5 of section 1, believe it or not. So we went down 1, 2, 3. It's the fourth one. It's where the arrows are going left and right. This is really weird, okay? On the screen, it tells you what foot you should use. In this case, I've got the J foot in, and it's perfect foot to use it. You can see that it's the stitch. Whoops, sorry. We're going to put all that back on. The stitch that I've chosen is a straight stitch. In this particular mode, and when we're doing left, right, and different angles, it's very limited to what you can do, and the machine makes crazy noises. Watch what we're going to do. We're gonna go down at an angle towards me to the right. And that's 5-08. All right, let's see what happens. Now, I'm not going fast. I could go faster, but I'm choosing not to. Now, remember, I've programmed it to stop. I'm going to do a back stitch. Sorry, reinforcement stitch. And check it. Look at that. Isn't that cool? I mean, that is super cool. The stitch length is, you can't change it here, but that's about close to a 2.5. Might be a little larger than 2.5 millimeters, but that is fabulous. All right, so let's end it there. Let's put the foot down. All right, where else can we go? How about if we go down to the left at an angle? All right, let's see what she does. She did a reinforcement stitch first, and now she's moving down and left. That's so cool. Did a reinforcement stitch. And because we had programmed it to automatically cut, that's what it will do. So this gives you so many options. You can do really, if you're doing stitch in the ditch, and you want to do maybe not stitch in the ditch, but doing X's in small squares, this is a great option to keep that line perfectly straight. It's a lot of fun. You have a whole lot of different ideas here. You can go from bottom to top at an angle, both ways, left and right. Let's go left. We'll do one more and then we'll move on. All right, and this one is going to go left. That's really cool. I think this is a lot of fun. This is both the ballad and the chorus have that. So I think that's a whole lot of fun, and you can have a lot of fun with this. All right, let us go back. All right, so we took your quilting stitches. It gives you a variety of different things you can do. There are 3 pages of stitches that you can use for quilting if you'd like. If you're piecing, there you have 3 choices. It has a P next to it. It all depends where you want your needle. Most people who use the quarter inch foot are going to use the Q-01 because that is where it's centered in the middle, and your quilting, your quarter inch quilting foot would have just a hole in the middle of it. So this would change it automatically and get it ready for piecing. Now, if you look down to the bottom, you'll notice that it says here width, and it's a black box with white lines. It means you cannot change the width, meaning you cannot move the needle. We're doing a straight stitch, you actually can't change the width, but you can move the needle. In this particular stitch, you cannot. Here's the length right next to it. This says 2.0 millimeters. That's their optimal piecing length. I know there are times if you want to do it larger or smaller, and that's your choice, and you can change that. And notice that when you change it, it goes from a black box with white numbers to grayed out with the numbers in black, okay? Left, right shift, I can't move the needle. It's not going to allow that, okay? And your tension, I can increase it or decrease it here just for this stitch. So I could change it for here, but if I go to a different stitch, it's not going to be there. Let's put it back to the default, which is in the little black box. All right, so that takes care of our quilting stitches. Let's go buttonholes. You'll have to attach your buttonhole foot, and you have a variety of buttonholes depending on what you're doing it for, whether it's a coat, a shank, a flat button, a keyhole. There's a variety of different stitches. You have your eyelet stitch, and then 418 is actually your button stitch where you stitch your button on. 415 and 416, that's your mending stitch. That is if you're repairing something. And we can do that. So let's change our foot and we'll do a mending stitch. I'm going to put it on 416. The machine tells me that I need foot A. I'm going to grab foot A. And here's your buttonhole foot. To remove your foot that's on here, you push the little black button behind. It releases your foot. And I'm going to put this and line it up underneath. I can either pop it up or drop the foot. I'm just going to pop it up. When you're doing mending, you want to be able to tell the machine how much of a mending piece do you need. If you were making a buttonhole, this is where you would put your button. I'm not going to do a huge mending piece. I am going to disappear for a second and get a piece of fabric. All right, so I grabbed a bright yellow. All right. Now, if I had a hole in here, let's just make a hole. Okay. And this is something you can see. There's a hole. I would have to repair it. So I would not use neon yellow. And I would not use black thread. But this will give you an idea of what this machine can do. I would match the fabric behind it. Does it have to be the exact fabric? No, but I would try to get close. You could do it larger than the actual hole, and then you could trim it off after. Okay, I've made a small, I'll do a little bit, yeah. I've made a size, that's probably way bigger than we need. That's about 3/4 of an inch, I'm gonna guess. Now I've chosen, I'm in my buttonhole section. I've got the correct foot. There's a picture of what it's gonna look like. I've got the design. The stitch I've chosen is 416. 415 is a little different. It's a little thinner and not as heavy. So technically, if it was something that's going to fray a lot, I may use the heavier one. I'm going to do the heavy duty one just so you can see what it does. All right. On here is a green, the letter A, so we know what foot it is. Down here, you're not going to be able to see it. There's three red lines, one in the center and one to the left and right, where you can line up where you need to start. And I'm going to put it right there. Drop my foot. Now, in order for my buttonhole to work, let's just step on the foot and see what happens. Now, button is still red. Let's see what it says. So it says, lower the buttonhole lever. It even shows you a picture of where it is and what it does. So we're going to take the one on the left, and I'm going to bring it down. When I did that, the green light came on. Make sure that your lever is behind this metal piece. If it's in front, it's not going to go very far. Now, I don't really need the foot pedal because I can do this automatically. When I unplugged the foot pedal, it turned red and then it went right back to green. Let's push the start and stop button and see what it does. So it's going back and forth right now over that hole that I made. Now, if I was using the exact same color thread as the color of the fabric and the patch that I put behind it was the exact same color, there's a good chance you won't see a thing when it's done. And right now it's going left to right. It's just about done. Lift my foot, and there we go. I mean, you can see the black, obviously, but you can barely see the yellow. So if this was the same color altogether, you would hardly see that at all. And then if you wanted to trim off that. So this is a great for mending. It's a fabulous thing. Can't do that with socks, because socks, you'd have to cut them apart, so don't do socks. All right, let's go into our character decorative stitches. It says okay to delete the selected pattern. It knew I was sewing something, so it wants to ask, are you sure you want to leave? We're going to say okay. I'm going to put the buttonhole lever back up, slide it up, remove the buttonhole foot itself, put it back away. Put the J back on. Okay. All right. So what we're going to do, let's choose something out of number 6. Now I've got black thread. So where is another piece of fabric? Here we go. reason I'm doubling it is so it doesn't pucker. Because when you're sewing something together, you normally have more than one piece of fabric together. All right, so let's look, and we have 36 pages, but we're not gonna do 36 different ones. We're gonna make this simple. A lot of these, like this particular one, 6-019, you can use this for like a blanket stitch or an applique, do something fancy. So I want you to, when you get your machine, start playing with it. There's a lot of good things in here. This almost looks like a tree. You've got all these crazy designs. This one looks like honeycomb. So I chose it. It says foot N. And here, if you look at it, you can see what it looks like when you're done. My foot pedal's plugged in. I can drop the foot from my sitting position and I can start it. Now, with this, I want to show you something different. You've got some buttons right here. Okay, whoops. I didn't want that. Okay, I hit close and it just disappeared. All right, so this first little square button, that is for when you're doing free motion. Second little button, and you wouldn't do free motion in your decorative stitch pattern, so you would stick to a straight stitch. This one here is, you can do multiple different designs together. Third one has three stars in orange, dark orange, and then you have one singular star in a lighter orange. The three stars tell you that it's a continuous design. So if I were to start sewing, this would be continuous. If I push this button, it's going to do one little stitch. That's it. It's going to do one of whatever design this is. And you can see by multiples, it creates the honeycomb effect. But doing it one just gives you that. So if you were just putting a little star, we'll say, on collars or something, or swirls. If you're doing a swirl, I could add a swirl and then I could go back to the honeycomb and we can do some loop-de-loos. You can get pretty crazy when you do this, but because I'm only choosing one of each of those stitches. So let's see what it does. All right, I'm gonna put my pivot foot back on. I'm gonna put my automatic backstitch and my automatic cut on. When I went from utility to character, this deleted itself. So you have to put it back on when you start there. So let's see what happens. It did a reinforcement stitch. Now I've got my foot pressed down all the way to the bottom and I have my speed level all the way up. The machine is not gonna go faster than it can go with the particular style of stitch that it's doing. Other stitches, like say if I was doing a straight stitch, this would be fine. It would be going much faster. On the screen, you can see that it's disappearing after it finishes the stitch. Now it finished the crazy stitches I just chose. And you can see, if I put them next to it, it's the exact same thing. That's pretty crazy. Now, if I like this crazy stitch and I'm like, man, I want to do that for the whole seam or the whole whatever, I'm not top stitch it. I'd go back to the stars, I would hit them, and it would do this continuously until I tell it to stop. Okay? All right. We're going to delete that because I don't think we need all these. And you can tell it's deleting them one at a time. All right. And then I went back to three stars with only one singular. So if we did that, all right, so we're stitching along and I'm trying to put this and put it in a certain area where I want it to end at a certain spot so it doesn't go off onto a seam. I can push my reinforcement stitch and what it'll do is it's gonna finish the end of that particular stitch, because remember that stitch singular looks like a little person without arms. See, and then it looks like a honeycomb when it's together. It will finish the stitch when you put the reinforcement stitch, and that's where it will stop. So if I wanna say, well, if I have a snowflake or a star, I don't want half a star, I want the whole star. Well, if you tell it to stop at the end of that design, it will stop at the end of that one design. So if I was doing this continuously, then if I was halfway through the second set of them, I could push that button, the reinforcement stitch or the donut button, and it would continue, finish that set of stitches, and then stop, okay? Lots to learn with this machine, and we are not going to be able to cover everything with this machine because there is so much to learn. All right, the next thing we're going to talk about is changing the foot and taking the whole ankle off to change an entire foot. We can put the digital dual on, and then we'll also put on one of your free motion feet. Got a little screwdriver. So when you're taking off a foot, and we'll go over it, just removing the actual foot itself down here, a little black button behind, push it, foot drops. We did this with the buttonholer, but we'll go over it. And this is the quarter inch foot. You can also just pop it up, or you can push the button down and try to line it up that way. All right, so again, push the button, line it up, and if you wanna just kind of line it up and guess, you can do that way. I didn't catch the foot, so what I can do is lift the back and then kind of move the foot to where you can see it so it lines up, and then you can drop your presser foot, okay? All right, let's take that off. All right. Now, take off the ankle. There's a little button, a little screw on the side, and you want to unscrew it, and it takes off your ankle. When you put on your free motion foot, you want to make sure that the opening is facing this way. It's open in the front. This piece here is going to go where the screw is, and then this piece on top with a plastic coating cover on it will sit on top of your needle bar. And once you have it on there, it moves around a lot. You can hand tighten it. And then if you'd like, you can tighten it with a little bit of a screwdriver. So in this mode here, we've got the free motion foot. So in order for us to use the free motion foot, you would come over here to your utility stitches and keep it in a straight stitch. This button here looks like a phone with a cord. You want to push that little button. If you look here, on top of your screen, it'll have the letter O, and that's what foot this is a letter O, and it's a straight stitch. You look here, there are no feed dogs, okay? They are gone. They have dropped down automatically because you told the machine that you are doing free motion, and this is where you would still engage your tension, and then you would quilt in here. Let's see, I do have a piece. I do. And I've got a little quilt sandwich. Let's put that underneath. And we'll just kind of start in the middle. I'm gonna drop my foot. Now with this particular feature, what I like about this machine, and the Ballad has it also, is you can unplug the foot. And then I can control the speed with my speed setter here. With this controller, I can go really, really slow or somewhere in the middle. This helps you to not be too concerned with how fast you're going and worrying about that foot going up and down and being inconsistent in your speed. You can find your best place of what speed you like, and then from that you can go. So now, because we don't really have a backstitch on this because there's no feed dogs, pushing these is going to be useless. So I'm just going to start and leave my needle in that position for a count of three. And then I'm going to start stitching. Now, if this is going too slow or I'm going too fast, which I usually am, there we go. Now this takes a lot of practice. It's not something that comes natural, at least for me. But you can see my stitches are pretty bad right now. All right, let's cut. Oh. All right, so doesn't look too bad on the front. Stitches are inconsistent They're different sizes because I'm not used to doing this at an angle, first of all. If I look on the back, besides me making a mess at the very beginning, my threads look pretty good. So I didn't tie it off, so that's where that is. And I did tie that off, but you can see how I moved too fast and that created something we call eyelashing. To fix that, you can either slow down like I should have, or I can increase my tension just a little bit, and then I'll take care of those eyelashes on the corners. All right, so that's kind of easy to do. It's something that you need to practice with. It doesn't come like just push a button and go. You have to practice. So you make a lot of sandwiches like this and practice with them. So to change your foot, so that's basically how you change your foot and how to use that. Now, to get out of this mode, I can go and tell the machine that I'm no longer going to be doing free motion. I unclick it. You can tell how it's going back to the J foot, except my feed dogs didn't come back up yet. I'm not worried about them. I'm going to take this foot off, loosen it up, let me get it off all the way. Okay. It goes in there. You also have a glide foot you can use. That's that plastic one that looks like a little bowl. With this particular foot, this is your digital dual foot. This has got a nice foot. This pops off. You can actually buy extra feet for this and have a different ones. This is very handy. This is basically your walking foot. With this, because it's a digital dual, it has its own little motor inside, so you have to plug it into the electricity, and that's on the back of your machine. To put this on, come from the back, and you want to line it up, and you want to make sure it's in there snug. Hand tighten it. And then I would use the screwdriver because this is a heavy piece there. On the back, it's back here. You're going to plug that in. Come on, I'm back here and you can't see a thing, so yeah. Okay, it's in nice and tight. When I do that, if you look on the screen again, it now says DF. Digital feed, okay? My feet are still down, my little feed dogs, they're not up yet. I can drop my needle and then pull it back up, lift my foot up, and then my feed dogs are back. Okay, that's all you have to do. And technically, you don't even have to do that. They would just come up automatically when you started stitching. All right, the digital dual foot will not allow you to do certain stitches. If you look on the screen here, you'll see that I'm in 1-03 and it's fine. And if I choose other ones, I seem to be okay. If I try to do this one, which is grayed out, it's gonna tell me this stitch is not dual feed mode compatible. So I cannot do that stitch at all. The machine is not gonna let me do stitches it cannot do, and you'll see that these stitches, same thing. You cannot use the digital mode, so the machine is not gonna allow you to mess up, which I think is great. Let's put it in the middle. All right, so we have, let's do back to the quilting piece, and let's see what we can do. All right, a digital dual is like a walking foot. I'm gonna drop my foot pedal as soon as I plug it back in. Okay, I'm gonna drop my foot pedal. Does it all by itself because I've programmed my foot, if you remember. Now I've got here, it because I've changed, it's deleted everything that I told it to save. It's not going to save it permanently, it just does it for the time until you're getting out of different stitches. I'm going to put my back stitch back on. I'm gonna do my automatic cut back on, and I'm do my pivot back on. So if I start stitching, you'll see that it's doing that straight stitch I told it to do. It did the back stitch at the beginning. Now I'm telling it to do a back stitch, and because I did the automatic cut, it does that nice and clean. Well, you can see it did the reinforcement stitch at the beginning, back stitch at the end. Look at that, nice and clean. Looks really, really good. Digital dual foot is very nice to use. I would still pin my quilt top or spray it with some 505. All right, digital dual foot is also good for heavy fabrics. If you've got something heavy duty, this can really make a difference. So I'm putting in 1, 2, 3, 4, let's do 5 layers of jean. I'm gonna put it under, put it on the end, drop my foot, and let's see what she does. Now that is nice. Look at that. Can't do that with a lot of machines. And I barely touched the fabric. The only reason why it was moving is because it has more weight on the left side than the right. So that's a fabulous, look at that, 5 layers of jean. And this is that heavy duty, like the old Wrangler jean, not the stretchy kind of jean. Nice job. All right, so now we're gonna go on to something special. Let's see, what have we done? I didn't show you one thing that's really cool. We talked about locking this down at the bottom. Automatically lowers the presser foot so you can actually change needles and whatnot. I'll turn that back on. Up here, there is a little lock. Okay, and you're like, well, it didn't do anything. You turn this blue, but that's it. All right, well, let's see what it did. And look. It can thread it. It can do it that way. But it can't change. It's not going to change anything. So let's put some fabric underneath it and see what it does. Look at that. So your lock doesn't lock your machine. It locks your stitch. So it won't lock the machine. If you want to lock the machine, you would push that. And look at that. I can't even do that because I've locked the screen here. So if you've got a little one and while you're sewing, they're over here pushing this, it's not going to change anything. Here, you will. So that's kind of a neat safety feature, really. If you want to lock your kids out completely, what I would do is lock it here. Low is the foot, and then they can't do anything. Okay? Make sense? I thought so. Cool. All right, let's move on to, we're not gonna do lettering because it's basically the same as your character. Decorative stitches, you just choose your letters and that. If you wanted to save something, I didn't show you how to do that. Let's do that. And then we will go on to exclusively what the chorus has. All right, let's go to character stitches real quick. I need to unplug the digital dual, hang on. All right, with it unplugged, the machine doesn't recognize that the foot is on, even though I've left it on. We're not gonna actually stitch this. I'm gonna save something. So let's go over to your stitches. And here it looks like a clover of some sort. I'm gonna choose that. Shows you 3. I'm gonna go down to 1. I only want 1 little guy. And then I'm gonna do a little, looks like a little tulip. And then I'll do a different flower. And then I go back the other way. So it has 5, started with 7-029, went to 028, 027, and then went back the other way. Say I wanna save that. I love that stitch, I'm gonna use it over and over again. Little pocket over here, you wanna push it. Now where do I wanna save this? Well, I wanna save it to the machine. Or I can save this right here is your middle one, that's your USB. I can put a USB jump drive in there and it will save that particular pattern on there. But if I want to use it again, I need to make sure I plug that USB back in when I go to retrieve it. I'm going to save it on the machine. Told me it saved it. All right, there you go. That's pretty easy. Let's go back to utility stitches. I'm deleting the pattern here, not deleting it completely, just deleting it off the screen. All right, let's go on to something else. So now I want to show you something that the chorus has that the ballad does not have. This is wicked cool. All right, when you attach your pin, which is over here, it has, I closed it in the drawer, it's attached to the machine, which you plug in, and it also has this little caddy, I guess is a good thing, where you can put your pen in your stylus, all schnazzy. All right, so this would pop out, and the directions to put the pen and plug it in is in your manual. Now, when you do this and you get your machine, you have to calibrate this according to your touch. So your how you hold your pen, whether it's your left hand or your right hand. So I would suggest that you decide, okay, I'm going to be the one using it, blah, blah, blah. This is how I hold it. In the manual, it goes exactly step by step by step, and it shows you exactly what to do to calibrate it. I am not going to walk through that with you on this because calibration is all about your touch and how you hold your pen. The book is perfect. I've walked through it. Really, really clear. Baby Lock does a great job with that. If you have any issues with calibrating, you can call the store, and then we can set up something to try to help you out with that, and that'll be no problem. All right, but right now I'm going to show you what this little baby does after you calibrate it. I'm going to put it back in the little stylus holder. All right, now on your screen, and we're going to keep straight stitch. I've got a regular foot on here. Let's see. Let's put it over to a simple straight stitch. It's on the left-hand side with a back stitch. Nice and easy. All right, more icons. So remember, we've talked about this one. This is the free motion. I didn't talk about this one. This is a mirror image. Of course, the mirror image of a straight line is a straight line. That would be something if you were doing more decorative stitches or if you want to flip something over to the other way. Next one is it has a picture of three needles, a one needle singular by itself and two needles, which is what a twin needle would be. In your packet of goodies, in your little white bag, there's a little spool piece. It looks like this, but much smaller, and it fits right here, so you can do another spool of thread, or you can use this, and then you can do your twin needle. And again, like the digital dual foot, it won't allow you to do certain stitches with two needles. It knows better. So if you choose the twin needle, there's certain stitches it will not allow you to do, which is a benefit for the user. All right, last one. It looks like I don't know what, but it's the pen. It's the sensor pen, so let's choose it. All right, so we've got a variety of icons. All right, I'm gonna choose this one. Okay, excuse me, I'm gonna put that down. It makes a funny noise. Okay, now notice here, I hope you can see it. Can we see it? The flashing red. Hey, how about if I tilt? Hang on. Oh, let me take off the... Let's take this. And it's not optimum to not have that, but at least you guys can see it. How's that? Ta-da! Look at that. Now, I have this set on 101-01, which is needle on the far left. Can you see that flashing red light? All right, cool. All right, so let's just say I need to move it over just a little teeny tiny bit. Well, technically, I could move it over with my width stitch button. I can move it over. But if I'm lining something up and I want it exact, the screen says touch the needle position with the sensor pen. So I'm going to touch the little dot right there. I just touched it because I use it as a point so you know what I'm doing. Notice that the flashing red is now on that little dot that I just touched. Okay, nothing's happened. It's all I'm doing. You're like, no, I don't like it there. Let's move it over a little bit more. Okay, oh, look at that. It's right there on the quarter inch. I want it there. All right, so now I'm going to put this down. All right, so as I'm touched the screen here, or actually the plate, this has changed with millimeters. It's gone from different places. Ah, see, I didn't hear anything. I heard the beep, but I didn't hear it move over all the way over. So let's look at here now. So now since we've seen the blinking, let's look this way. All right, I'm gonna move this. Look at that. Notice where the red line is. That's where I lined it up. It's 1.0 millimeters from the left-hand side. Let's move it a little bit more. All right, look. Now, touch the needle position with the sensor pen, which I did. Look where I moved it to. It's at 4.0 millimeters. So it's like I'm moving the needle, but all I'm doing is touching the screen, well, the plate. The needle hasn't moved. You're like, okay, so what am I supposed to do? All right, let's test it. I'm going to put this here. Now, I want you to watch the needle, okay? I'm gonna point to it so you guys can pay attention. And I'm gonna hit okay on the screen on the count of three. One, two, and three. Ha ha, did you see that? It moved, just went bloop, and it put the exact spot that I wanted it to go in that we touched. Now, if I look at it, look on here on the screen again, look at the width. It's 4.0 millimeters. Isn't that what it was when we were on with the pen? Haha, it was. How cool is that? So then you can get more precise. Maybe you are stitching over something, there's a line, I don't know. You can do all kinds of crazy things and line things up. And I think that's fabulous. If you look here now on the screen, it still shows you what stitch you're doing, which is the straight line in this case, but there's no more red line. It's gone because we've moved it to the exact position we want it to be in. All right, now let's go back. Let's see. It's because I'm not doing a zigzag. If I was doing a zigzag, let's close this and choose a zigzag. I'm gonna go back to the sensor pen. Now my left-right needle mover thing is grayed out, so I can no longer use that because I'm in a zigzag stitch, but I can do this. Let's check it out. All right, touch the first point of the stitch width using the sensor pen. Won't let me drop my foot. Okay, I wasn't sure if it would or not because I'd like to have it done. All right, so let's say how far left do I want it to go? So what width do I want? I don't really know. So let's just remove the fabric so we can censor. All right. So it's all the way over. I moved it all the way to 0.0. Can you see it? All right, number two. So touch, we've done that. Now I need to do this, touch the first point of the stitch width using the censor pen, which I've done. All right, and say okay. All right, so now my left side of that zigzag is set. Now it says touch the second point of the stitch width using the sensor pen, so the pen. Now I'm choosing the opposite way. So how far over do I want to go with that? And I've got it at 7. Let's do a little less. There's 5.0 millimeters. I just want something small. So I'm going to say okay. Now watch the needle. Didn't look like it moved, did it? Well, let's see what happens. All right, so we're just gonna use my foot pedal and see what it does. Look at that. See what it's doing? It's going exactly the width that I told it to do. And we'll backstitch it. And look at that. Now, if I measured this with a little measuring thing with millimeters, it would be exactly the size I told it to. In this case, it's exactly 5 millimeters, which is super cool. So this can be very helpful when you're trying to move something over or you want the exact size. If you're following something, maybe an old pattern, and I don't know, you can use your imagination with stitches and movements. That's a lot of fun. All right, let's go back to our standard stitch. Go back to the pen. Let's see what this one is. This is touch the ending point using the sensor pen. So you're like, what? So let's see what happens. So, touch the ending point using the sensor pen. So I need to get out of here first. I need to go, whoops. Okay, to delete the setting. And we're gonna go into character design. That's where I can better use it. Okay. Touch the ending point using the sensor. Let's see. Here we go. Looks like it says 29.8 millimeters, which is 1.17 inches. If you go outside, I'm just going to put this here for a second. If you go outside its range, it's not going to do anything. So if I was over here, nothing's going to happen. If I go too far, see, an invalid area was touched. So this tells you I can't stop it that far away. Okay, touch again within this the active sensor area, which is about 8 inches. So, oh, I gotta close that, sorry. All right. Again, it's just still not where I need it to be. Ah, there we go. This is 5.66 inches from the needle. So if I was doing something and that's exactly the length that I needed, I could do that. So I'm gonna keep that there. I'm gonna say okay. All right, and now remember, we chose those little flowers. They look like little tulips. And this is more than 5 inches. So let's see what happens. Let's move this a little bit there. All right. Might take a minute because we're going to almost 6 inches. Let's see what it does. This is a pretty design. This is going in one direction. It's not flipped. I didn't mirror it. So it's going, looks like a little scoop. Ah. Now my foot is to the floor. All right. Reconfirm same ending point using the sensor pen. Okay. I don't know how I'm going to do that if it's not. Touch position is too far away from the original. Touch the same ending point using the sensor pen. Well, it's a little hard because we guessed, didn't we? Yeah, I didn't. I should have put the table back on. Sorry. But we could use it. Well, I reset it that way. That is confirming same ending point using the sensor pen. So now it did. I'm going to lift the foot. Oh, I'll do it manually. All right. If you look, you probably can't see. Hang on. Let me tilt. All right, we have 1, 2, 3 little tulip smiley faces. I don't know. Let's put this back down. So even though it told me I couldn't use it, I made it work. All right, so this foot's back on. Reconfirm, saying okay. Let's see what it does now. Here we go. So it looks like, hang on, let's cut it so we can see it. And it just did the same, look how small that went. See that? It changed the length. Let me point. They changed the length of these into that smaller piece. That's interesting. This looks like little circles now instead of little tulips. I'm not sure what I would use that for. I suppose I would probably have to play a whole lot. And that's kind of the point is, I may be showing you how to use it, but I want you to be able to sit here, maybe choose the same pattern and play with it. So then you know what you can do with your machine. I don't own the Chorus, but I can play with her at work, which is kind of nice. I get to play with all the machines, but I don't know them inside out and everything I do because I don't have one at home. I have other Baby Lock machines. So we've got back to this. Let's see. All right. So this says touch the guideline marker position using the sensor pen. Well, let me pick the pen back up. Let's see what we're going to do now. Okay. So notice now, if you look on the screen, I've got those little tulip dudes still there, but the laser is here. So let's say if I was trying to line this up perfectly with right below a stitch line on a quilt or a baby bib where the line is there. I don't want to draw a line on it with a marking pen, so I can literally line it up with a piece of fabric and know how far this particular design is away from that line. So if I had drawn a line and I'm like, well, I want that right there, I can line it up perfectly. So that's kind of cool. I like the laser in that aspect. Let's clear all this. Let's go back to my utility. Let's go in the middle. All right, so if you're a quilter, you do probably half square triangles. And the old fashioned way to do a half square triangle is with a ruler of some sort, or marking pen or pencil of some sort, and fabric. You normally would, if you wanted to do a half square triangle, you would take this and draw a line, and I'll hold it up when I'm done. Draw a line. There we go. Can't see, it was too thin. Made it a little bit bigger for you. All right. You can see the purple line, right? Okay. Let me put the table back on so it's a little easier for me. And thank you. All right, how do I delete that? Okay, there we go. So when I was in that mode, I chose this and I moved it. So let's say it's at 6.0 millimeters. If I wanted to keep that there, I'd say okay, and it stays there. And I can minus or plus it, see? I can do it manually or I can do it with a pen. That can be very helpful. If I don't want that at all, I'm gonna hit that little black spot with the red line and then it disappears, okay? If I want it back, I can put it back and then I can move it. So 3.5 would be smack dab in the middle of your foot. So if I had a quarter inch foot on here, we'll say. All right, well, old way of doing this, as I'd have to draw a line and then I would put my quarter inch foot on and then I would sew a quarter inch on one side and then I would turn it around and I'd sew a quarter inch on this side. Total pain in the butt. Of course, we get used to it, so it doesn't really bother us. Let me show you a trick. Now, if I were to do this, now where's my needle? If you look at it, it's directly in the center, okay? My laser light is in the center. Well, I think I wanna move my foot, my needle over to the right or to the left, so I'm stitching a quarter inch from the line. So do I have to draw that purple line? I don't. So let's do it this way. I'm gonna move my needle so my laser's in the middle and I wanna move my needle. Now, how do I know it's a quarter inch? That's a problem. So what would you do? Well, I would probably get a ruler out and measure it. Well, that's a pain. I don't want to do that. Let's go back to smack in the middle. There we go, 3.5. Let's see what our pen can do. I'm going to choose the pen. I want to move my needle, okay? Let's move it over. That's too far. 5.5. Let's see what that looks like. So I'm going to say okay. So my needle is over on the far right at 5.5 millimeters. My laser is smack dab in the middle. So I'm able to move my needle without moving the laser, okay? Let's say if I want to move, let's see, so I could actually stitch this. Now I'm gonna drop the foot and let's see, where's my pointing? The other pointer. There it is. All right, so I'm gonna stand up so you can see this. All right, so here is my laser, right in the middle. Now I'm not over very far, because remember, this is 3.5, this is 5.5, so I am 2 millimeters over to the right. That is not a quarter of an inch. So I wanna go a little further over. So let's move this the other way. Nope, wrong way, sorry. Now I'm at 7. So that's 3.5 millimeters from the center. So if I dropped it there, let's see. That is not a quarter of an inch, but that's pretty close. It's almost like a scant. So if I was doing something scant, oh, I hate using that word, but that would help also. I'm gonna put the needle back up, put my foot back up and take the thread out, okay. Let's say you are, what else can we do? You're quilting, uh-huh. And you have stitch in the ditch, you have lines that your seams were on and you wanna finish, but you want to move it over just a little bit. So we wanna move that. So if our seam, we need a marker. Hey, this is our stitch seam. That's where our blocks are sewn together. I wanna line up. I can line that up on the seam, drop my foot. Now I've moved the needle over to the far right at 7.0 millimeters. As long as I keep this laser on that line, look at that, it's a perfect line. So if I wanted to do it the other way, on the other side of that stitch, line it up, drop my foot, keep that laser light on that seam, well, in this case it's a purple line. So you could literally do equal amounts on, well, if that was a seam, or even just a stripe, however you wanted to do it, you can measure exactly on both sides, which that's pretty cool. I think that's pretty neat. I like that. When I'm doing half square triangles, if I'm doing, or if I have a pattern that wants me to just, like, just stitch down the middle, some patterns, they don't want you to do like two, they just want you to do one because you need that particular size. Well, if I have the laser light on and it's in the middle, let me move the needle back over. And you'll notice that my needle and the laser are the same. I'll move it back. See, there's my stitch line, there's my laser line, but I want it in the middle. I don't need a purple line. I can line this up so I know that's the middle. Drop my foot. I'm gonna increase my length just because I don't wanna permanently stitch this fabric. But I can just stitch it and follow the red line so it's lined up perfectly at to the point. Follow it down to the end. Now I've done a whole bunch of small triangles with this particular machine and I was able to zoom through them by just lining them up in the small ones. This is a large one, and then I had to cut off the edge. The pattern required a funny size, so it didn't want you to do a half square. So it just did that. So this is smaller than, but still, that line is better than using a marker or having to take the time to use a ruler, you can just use that straight laser to keep it nice and straight. I love that. I think that's fabulous. All right, that wraps it up for the Baby Lock Ballad and Chorus. If you have any questions about it, please just give our store a call. We'd love to help you in your projects, and we want you to get the best out of your machine. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.